correction, then the kind of lasers using laser vision correction, then the and the complications and management. These are some of the questions that have come in the past. Mainly the workup and the complications have been repeated a lot of time, and even smile has come. Jose Ignacio Barraquer is considered as the father of modern refractive surgery. Then the first question that arises is why a patient needs laser vision correction. So mostly it is the patient wants to get rid of the glasses or the contact lenses they are wearing, and certain occupations they require the vision to be at a certain distance also. Then the pre-op patient evaluation is the most important part, because laser vision correction is an elective procedure which is done on normal eyes, and the FDA approved minimum age for laser vision correction is 18 years. So first, coming on to the general medical history, diabetes mellitus is the first thing because of following reasons. First, there is a delayed healing in these patients. They are more susceptible to infections. And moreover, in poorly controlled diabetics, their preoperative refraction might not be precise because of the changing lens hydration status. And patients with diabetic retinopathy, microangiopathy, as well as neuropathy are to be excluded. Then coming to the autoimmune and collagen vascular diseases. So in these, after surface ablation, because of the excessive fibroblast activation, there can be a high level of ACE, and LASIK is contraindicated in them in the active phase of the disease. But in the inactive phase, it can still be done, but with prolonged post-op steroid. Then, moreover, some of these patients might be on immunomodulatory therapy, so which also further increases the risk of infection. Next, in pregnancy and breastfeeding, the refraction is still unstable due to a change in the corneal hydration status because of hormonal changes. And post refractive surgery, we prescribe steroids, which I pass on to the baby or into the fetus. So we should always wait for 3 months post delivery or breastfeeding, after breastfeeding, for laser vision correction. Then in thyroid endocrinopathy, it changes the dynamics of the lacrimal film, as well as there are eyelid changes which can pose problem in the post-op period. Then seizure disorder. In the seizure disorder, they must be well controlled before the surgery, because the target light of the laser or the treatment itself can induce a seizure during the treatment. Then atrophy. So the,
just a second. Yeah, you're finished with the all the things?
No, ma'am. Atrophy. I am on atrophy now.
Okay. Fine. Go ahead.
Yeah. So there is a frequent association between atopic dermatitis and keratoconus. Moreover, during allergic conjunctivitis, laser vision correction is not done. Then in the immunodeficient state, such as AIDS, cancer, and on immunosuppressive therapy, increases the risk of infection. And lastly, we should take history of medications that the patient is on currently.
Okay, what medications would you like to check specifically, apart from what diseases that you have enumerated? Anybody wants to take the answer? Like, for example, patient on aspirin, what is the threat for LASIK? Anybody? Quickly?
Docking, well, docking the eye, hemorrhage can happen. So, that is one thing.
Yeah, so vascular liability and easily breakage of capillaries leading on to bleeding. So, bleeding on the bed, what will happen in case of LASIK?
It is very detrimental, ma'am, because having heme in between the interface itself will cause a very severe DLK. And second thing, that itself will incite an inflammatory reaction. And the hemosiderin, which is going to be a excrement of the blood itself, is going to cause a significant post-op.
Patient on antihistamines. These are important to ask the patient, whether they are on antihistamines. Why is it important? Like atopy, he said. What is the problem in patients who are on treatment for atopy? Aman, what did you tell?
Yes, ma'am. So antihistamines will affect the epithelial healing, ma'am.
So it will delayed healing. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, patient on anti-migraine medication. Specifically, you have to ask for them for anti-migraine medication. Any headache?
Sumatriptan. What is later can happen with the
Bowman's membrane dystrophy. Okay, very often they have Bowman's membrane dystrophy. Okay, go ahead.
So coming on to the social and occupational history, the first thing is that we need to understand the needs of the patient, because certain occupation require the best corrected visual acuity to be at a certain distance. And we also should look into the whether the patient is an athlete or working in a military, because of the risk of trauma. And in these patients, LASIK is not preferred. We prefer to do surface ablation, and tobacco and alcohol use should also be documented. Next, coming to ocular history, first is spectacle or contact lens use. So the stability of refraction is very important, because like the change in refraction should not be more than 0.5 diopter in either sphere or cylinder in the past 1 year. Then contact lens history includes the type of contact lens they are using, the usage of the contact lens, the type of cleaning and disinfecting agent they are using, then the age of the lenses and the duration of the wear. So before laser vision correction, they should stop the soft contact lenses for at least 2 weeks, the rigid gas permeable contact lenses for 2 to 3 weeks. Moreover, in long-term RGP users, they need to stop it for 1 month for every decade of use, or discontinue until the refraction and topography stabilizes. This occurs because of the contact lens-induced corneal warpage. Then coming to keratoconus and ectatic disorders, LASIK as well as other laser vision correction procedures are absolutely contraindicated because they weaken the corneal biomechanics and they can lead to the progression. Then dry eye history is also very important. Then in monocular patient, though the laser vision correction is not contraindicated, but since there is always a risk of complication, so these patients should be counseled and must be discouraged. And some of these patients might be having ocular prosthesis, which can be a source of infection. Then because of the risk of reactivation of herpetic eye disease, it is contraindicated in this. Then recurrent corneal erosions should be asked. Then history of glaucoma, because during laser vision correction, the IOP is increased to a very high level, which can further cause damage. And post-op steroids can also cause an increase in IOP in steroid responders. Then history of previous ocular surgery is very, very important. For example, in corneal surgery, post-keratoplasty, femtolasic is preferred over PRK because of less post-op days. And in trap surgery, after trap surgery, there is a difficulty in suction ring placement.
Just a second. Ocular exam. Just a second. All these contraindications that you have gone, let us go through it one by one, okay, in the reverse order. Yeah. Previous ocular surgery, is it an absolute contraindication? Is there any situation where we will tend to do a LASIK post-ocular surgery? Anybody?
Prior LASIK surgery.
Post-cataract surgery.
Post-cataract residual refractive error.
Yes, ma'am. Residual error. Anything, correct.
Anything else?
Post-PK, ma'am.
Post-PK, correct?
Post-ICL.
Post-ICL patients, ma'am.
Okay.
To correct the astigmatism.
Okay. So, then, in other words, this is a relative contraindication. The idea of putting it here is to be cautious. Important to ask, because each category requires a different strategy and setup of laser correction. So, it is important to note it. Glaucoma. Is glaucoma absolute contraindication? Quickly, if you answer only, then he has got 60 slides, man. You want to finish it by 6, you have to be fast. Is glaucoma an absolute contraindication?
Ma'am, because no, glaucoma, ma'am, with the progression and with the fields, the disturbance, the patient... complaints, yes, of disturbance, yeah, of peripheral fields that keep on changing. So our flap size.
Yeah, agree with Dr. Shripriya. She says IOP measurement post LASIK is a challenge. So monitoring post surgery also becomes a challenge. These patients are young patients. If they are young patients, if you're doing it around the teenage 20 years and glaucoma, we know that glaucoma is going to be worse when it starts early. So post-op monitoring and everything becomes a challenge. So you have to weigh your pros and cons whether to do or not to do. Then recurrent corneal erosion. Yeah, avoid those with strong family history, Dr. Avis tells us. Okay. Recurrent, thanks. Of glaucoma, correct. Recurrent corneal erosion. Is that an absolute no-no?
No. Quickly. For PRK, not a problem, but for LASIK, yes, it's a no-no.
Yeah. For LASIK, it's a no-no. For PRK, it's not a problem. Do you mean to say after PRK, the epithelial healing will be brilliant if the patient is prone for recurrent corneal erosions for Pranish?
No, ma'am. Primarily, I think the problem with the basement, the Bowman's layer gets resolved. So, I think the epithelialization will be better, but it's not like it's a 100% okay situation. We might
in other words, only for a specific situation, it is indicated. When it is indicated,
yes.
Only in a specific situation where debridement is the mode of treatment, like for the Bowman's dystrophy, this will be a helpful measure. Not in all situations.
Not
so, specific eye disease, Herpetic eye disease. What is the problem with herpetic eye disease?
It can get reactivated on.
Pardon?
A reactivation of the latent disease can happen.
This is an absolute contraindication. You shouldn't do, even in cases of suspicion, you should not do. But there are literature which says, if unknown or suspicious, not proven, not severe, you can do these cases. And the patient who have a real indication and high power for correction and unable to wear other modality of correction like glasses or contact lenses, then these can be taken under strict anti-herpetic treatments, systemic medication. So that is then monocular patients. Would you do monocular patients? Monocular LASIK is possibility. Quickly, please. Is monocular?
No, ma'am, because of the problem of ectasia regression, if it happens, it becomes a problematic first. Second thing, if the patient develop haze, then it's the only seeing eye. So.
But there are situations when monocular LASIK is being performed. Can you guess?
Monocular LASIK is done only for patients. I think for this presbyopia, ma'am. So. One eye for distant and one eye for near.
That is a different concept altogether. That is, you are talking about monovision. Monocular LASIK is done in situations where the other eye is beyond the scope of LASIK, where you have to go in for an ICL or something like that, or a cataract removal. Okay, that is one situation where you can. So each contraindication has got a little twist. That's what I'm trying to highlight. Go ahead, Aman. Yeah, anisometropia, correct?
Yeah, so next ocular examination, visual acuity and refraction. So the sharpest vision with the least minus should be the end point, and duochrome should not be used since it results in an over minus. And both manifest as well as the cycloplegic refraction are important. The manifest refraction is important because it gives more accuracy in determining the axis and amount of cylinder, and cycloplegic refraction is for refining the sphere. And if there is a great difference between the manifest and cycloplegic refraction, it indicates that either the patient is an over minus myope or there is a substantial latent hyperopia and hyperopia. And prisms, if any, should be noted. Next, coming on to the ocular alignment. So Hirschberg's test, Kerber test in the extraocular movement should be done. And because asymptomatic tropia or phoria may break down following change in refraction, so these patients can be given a trial of contact lens to simulate the post-op refractive outcome for a few weeks to see if there is a break in the ocular alignment. Next, coming on to the external examination, these conditions such as recessed globe, narrow palpable fissure, large nose and prominent eyebrows, they pose problem with positioning of the suction ring, the working of the microkeratome and the descent of the inclination cone. And most importantly, the corneal sensations should also be checked. Then coming on to the pupillometry, the pupil size can be determined with the Rosenbaum cards as well as the pupillometer. The simplest way is to do it in a dark room in a slit lamp. The thinnest possible slit with the minimum possible light should be used to measure the pupillary diameter. The importance is that it determines the size of the ablation zone, which should be 0.5 to 1 millimeter larger than the mesopic pupil size. Larger mesopic pupil size, more than 8 millimeter, is associated with postoperative glare and halos at night. So these patients need to be counseled. Next, coming on to the angle Kappa. So a large.
One second, Aman. What is the usual ablation area? Pane fellows?
The 6 to 6.
Ablation normally?
6 to 6.5.
Okay. So it is very important to see the mesopic pupil size. Anything beyond 6, what is the problem?
Night glare.
Night glare because of the transition zone. Yeah. So why not do a larger area ablation optical zone? Why can't we do a larger area of ablation to match the mesopic?
You have to burn more tissue. Cornea, ma'am.
Okay.
The larger the eyes, the
bone.
Burn more tissue.
Correct. That is the limiting factor. So the larger the area, the more is the ablation. The thinner the cornea is going to be. So you have a limitation between the pachy and the pupillary diameter, mesopic pupillary diameter. Okay. What are the angles there? The important axis that we need to know, visual axis, optical axis, corneal vertex, pupillary axis, all of these are very important when you are going to work with the LASIK. Can anybody tell me what is a visual axis?
Ma'am, point of recession through the macula through the nodal point.
Yes, that is a line of sight, correct? Okay, yes. What is the optical axis? optical axis through the
cornea, but it's in the cornea.
Yeah, center of the cornea and the lens.
Center of cornea and lens.
Okay, what is it that passes only through the center of the cornea? What is it called? Corneal vertex. Okay, what is pupillary axis? Okay, Haman, you continue. Nobody wants to answer. You continue.
So a large angle kappa can result in a decentered ablation. Next, coming on to the slit lamp examination. So on slit lamp examination, before slit lamp examination, first Schirmer's test should be done. Then on the slit lamp, additional tear film evaluation in the form of tear meniscus height and tear film breakup time can be done. Then we should specifically look for any lid abnormalities such as trichiasis, entropion, and ectropion. Then any source of infection and interface debris such as blepharitis, hordeolum, and pneumocystis should be ruled out. And any lacrimal puncta abnormalities also. Next, coming on to the cornea. So surface abnormalities, scar, edema, and vascularization should be seen. Vascularization is usually seen because these patients are long-term contact lens users. Then any dystrophy, either epithelial, stromal, or endothelial dystrophy should be looked into. And any signs of ectasia. Then cataract, if present, should be noted, and the patient should be counseled. Then tonometry and gonioscopy, and any signs of inflammation should be ruled out. Plus a detailed fundus examination up to the periphery of the retina is also very, very important. And the patient also needs to understand that LASIK does not increase the risk of retinal detachment, but patient undergoing LASIK surgery, especially the myopes, are predisposed to retinal detachment. Next, the ancillary tests. So the first is corneal topography and tomography. We should look into any source of irregular astigmatism, such as keratoconus, PMD, and contact lens warpage. The corneal topography also gives us the amount and axis of astigmatism. So if there is a gross deviation between this and the manifest refraction, so we should go back and check our manifest refraction also. Also, the corneas that are steeper than 48 diopters or flatter than 40 diopters, they have an increased risk of flat complications. Next, coming on to the pachymetry. So the central corneal thickness of less than 480 micron is not suitable for LASIK, even if the residual stromal bed is more than 250 micron, because future enhancement surgeries may not be possible later on. And the residual stromal bed is basically the pre-op central corneal thickness minus the flap thickness and minus the depth of ablation. And fundus photography and slit lamp photography for documentation of pre-existing pathology. Digital biometry should be recorded and should be given to the patient in case he needs a future cataract surgery. And aberrometry is also done sometimes.
Okay, just a second. This go back to the previous slide. This central corneal thickness of 480 and to a residual stromal bed of 250 is important, yes, but it is not the only criteria which we are looking at now. There are eyes which are thicker naturally, and there are corneas which are thinner naturally. Certain thinner corneas are found to be more biomechanically stable than certain thicker corneas, even if without any surgery performed. So the pachymetry alone is not enough. We have to look at the corneal strength, that is biomechanics also. So the single number of 250 or 480 is not just taken as a rule now. Future only, with more in detailed understanding of biomechanics and how the thickness plays into the biomechanics, will only tell us which single criteria should we take, or a combination of which pattern we should take. Yes, patients with keratoconus siblings also should be avoided. Thanks, Meena.
Next, very important is understanding patient's expectation. And in over-expectant patients should be avoided because they are not a good candidate for surgery. Then they should also understand that there will be a decrease in spectacle dependence, and it does not always mean that they will be spectacle free. And later on in future, they'll need presbyopia glasses eventually. And there will be no decrease or increase in the future risk of cataract, glaucoma, or retinal problem. And most importantly, patients should be counseled and informed consent should be taken, and all the risks and benefits associated should be discussed beforehand. Next, coming on to the lasers which are used in laser vision correction. So the first is photoablative laser. What happens in a photoablative laser, that one of the examples is excimer laser, which is also excited dimer. So in this, electrical energy is used to create a dimer between argon and fluorine, which is highly unstable, which breaks down and releases photon energy of approximately 6 electron volt, as you can see here, which is greater than the binding energy between the carbon-carbon and carbon-nitrogen in the corneal collagen, which leads to the ablation. And there is a vaporization of a layer of tissue, creating the plume effect. So argon fluoride laser is used only because the wavelength of this is less than 350 nanometer, and at less than 350 nanometer, the absorption predominates over transmission. So it is a ultraviolet. The corneal absorbance is also high at 193 nanometer, and there is a minimal thermal effect. That is why it is also known as cold ablation. There is a minimal collateral damage and minimal mutagenicity also. Next, coming to the photodisruptive laser, this highly focused beam of laser is thrown onto the cornea, which results in the formation of plasma, which expands very rapidly. So it separates the tissue planes, and due to the separation of tissue plane, there is a formation of cavitation bubbles, which is eventually absorbed by the corneal pump mechanism, or it is eliminated when the flap is lifted. This is known as the laser-induced optical breakdown. The example of this is femtosecond laser, which is a solid state laser which emits light in the wavelength of 1053 nanometer, which is infrared spectrum, and the pulse duration is of the order of 10 to the power minus 15, which is femto, and that is why minimal energy is deposited in the cornea, and pulses are always emitted from the deeper layer to the more superficial layers of the cornea. And you can see three patterns here. This is the raster pattern, this is the spiral out pattern, and this is the spiral in pattern. The advantage of spiral in pattern is that the centration with the laser light can be maintained till the very end of the disruptive procedure.
Yeah, why it is from the deeper layer to the surface layer for femto? Can somebody tell me? Or should it be?
Ma'am, because of haze, clarity decreases, so we lose from deeper to superficial.
What is it? Because of?
Haze, ma'am. Corneal haze comes, so from deeper to superficial, we'll do for clarity.
Okay, yeah. So you can see the deeper layers clearly while it is being done. As the bubbles form, you have to come above where the clarity is still maintained. The reverse order will obscure your view as well as the penetration of the laser. Okay? Yeah, go ahead, Anand.
Now coming on to the laser vision correction procedures. So basically the refraction can be altered by addition, subtraction, relaxation and coagulation compression. So I'll be dealing with the subtraction with the laser procedures. First, the indication for surface surgery over flap surgery. So we'll prefer the surface surgery in low to moderate myopia as well as myopic astigmatism. Patient indulging in contact sport or military because they are at an increased risk of flap related complications in thin corneas, in steep cornea and flat cornea, and patients with prior intraocular surgery such as penetrating keratoplasty and cataract surgeries. Absolute contraindication for laser vision correction are collagen vascular diseases, immunodeficiency disorders, then ectasias, herpetic and active external eye diseases, and advanced glaucoma. Next, the basic concept of laser vision correction is that in case of a myopic correction, we are actually removing more amount of tissue from the center than in the periphery of the cornea. So we are flattening the cornea in one way. In hyperopic ablation, we remove more amount of tissue in the mid periphery, which is a donut shaped area, which is removed. So which results in steepening of the central cornea. And the importance of blend zone is that to prevent the abrupt transition between the ablated and the non-ablated zone, a blend zone is created, which has no refractive correction, but it just smoothens the transition between the two. So coming on to the flap-based surgery, so the patient preparation is very important. Cleaning and draping is done, and opposite eye should also be covered to prevent cross-fixation. And in case both the eyes are to be done in the same sitting, we should also tape the opposite eye to prevent drying. Then conjunctival irritation should be avoided because it will pose problem with the suction placement. Then correct head positioning is also very important. As you can see here, these are three incorrect head positionings in which this is more, the patient is looking more up, this is more down, and this is tilted head, which should be avoided. And before doing the laser correction, instrument and laser should also be checked for proper functioning. Next, coming on to LASIK, which is laser-assisted in situ keratomyelosis, which is basically ablation under a lamellar flap, which means that we are doing it in the mid-stroma. There are two ways of creating the flap, which is either with a microkeratome or with a femtosecond laser. Here you can see a schematic of microkeratome, which is a highly sharpened blade, and it can also be used in eyes with corneal scar, because one of the prerequisites for a femtosecond laser is a complete corneal clarity, so which will not be there in a corneal scarred eye. Then this is the suction ring, which produces a suction on the sclera, which stabilizes the globe and which raises the IOP to the high level. And the dimension of the ring determines the flap size. Next, the aplanation head, as you can see here, it aplanates the cornea ahead of the cutting blade so that the cut can be smooth. Then before flap creation, always the IOP should be assessed. We should ensure adequate suction, and we should rule out pseudo suction, which is the suction of only the conjunctiva without a hold on the sclera. And we should ensure that the microkeratome path is free of any obstacles. So here you can see this is the suction ring, then the microkeratome, and the microkeratome has been put on the suction ring. So the flap thickness are of two types. One is the standard 120 to 180 micron, and one is the 80 to 100 micron, which is also known as sub-Bowman's keratomelusis, and this is the ultra-thin flap. So this is a femtosecond laser-based procedure. So you can see the suction cup, which is coming down on the cornea, and the suction will be put on by the foot pedal. Then you can see the apprenation cone that is coming down, which will apprenate the cornea, as you can see here. Next, this is the intrastromal vent incision so that the gas bubbles can escape. And now, as you can see, the photo disruption is happening, and the flap has been cut with the laser. Next, this is common to both the microkeratome as well as femtolaser. This is the actual ablation procedure. You can see the laser has compensated for the centroid shift of the pupil. And now the flying spot lasers are being thrown, which will ablate the cornea. Care should be taken during flap lifting. That is that only 1/3 of the flap should be dissected at a time after femtolasic application, because it decreases the risk of tearing. Then the advantages of femtolaser over microkeratome is that with the femto laser, we can customize the flap in terms of thickness, the diameter of the flap, the location of the hinge, as well as the hinge angle. There is a precise depth control, and the flap dimensions are precise, and the location is also very precise, and it results in a planar flap. That means that the thickness of the flap is comparable centrally as well as peripherally, and the flap can be centered intra-op also. Furthermore, it decreases the complications that are associated with microkeratome, such as pre-cap, buttonhole, and epithelial defects. The disadvantage is that there is a longer suction time, more flap manipulation, because the flap has to be dissected even after photo disruption. Then opaque bubble layer can form, which interferes with the examined laser ablation later on. And peripheral, so that is why peripheral intrastromal pocket is created to allow for that escape. And sometimes the bubble may appear in the anterior chamber, which may pose problem with tracking and registration. And there is an increased treatment time, and some patients may complain of transient light sensitivity post-op.
Then, yeah, what is the difference between a planar flap and a minuscule cut flap? Aman, you tell.
Ma'am, minuscule flap is, planar flap is like the dimensions are equal peripherally as well as centrally. They are comparable, and meniscus shaped flap is after a microkeratome use, ma'am.
Okay. What is the advantage of planar? Anybody?
The flap doesn't shift, ma'am.
Yeah, perfect opposition is possible. Okay, equal flap thickness is, yeah, flap thickness is equal all over. It nicely goes and sits in the space given. Whereas in planar, there is a high chance of override, slippage, and all that. Okay, so that is very important. That is why the predictability is also better with femtosecond laser along with the other issues.
So after the flap has been lifted, so the stromal bed is dried with a Wechsel sponge, because fluid and blood which is present on the stromal bed can cause irregular ablation. Then the examined laser ablation, as you have seen previously, the flying spot laser were applied, and it is done very quickly before excessive stromal dehydration occurs. And a flap protector can be put here to protect the flap from the laser ablations. Then immediately after ablation, the flap is replaced on the stromal bed. The interface is irrigated to remove any debris, and proper flap replacement is checked by looking at the peripheral gutter, which should be symmetric and even. And these are asymmetric ink marks that are placed on the cornea. This is done before cutting in case of a microkeratome, and before lifting the flap in case of a femtolasic. And these are very helpful if in case there is a free cap during the procedure. And the eye speculum later on should be removed very carefully. And at the end, topical antibiotics, NSAIDs and steroid are put, and the patient is put on a tapering schedule of steroids. NSAIDs and antibiotics are continued post-operatively, and the patient is asked to avoid swimming pools and eye rubbing for at least 2 weeks. Next comes LASIK extra. So LASIK extra is LASIK plus corneal collagen cross-linking, which can be done in patients who are at a greater risk of ectasia in the post-op period. Presbylasic creates a multifocal cornea, there are two types of presbyopia lasik. One is the central model and one is the peripheral model. In the central model, the near vision zone is present in the center, while in the peripheral model, the near vision zone is in the periphery. And pressed beyond is also known as laser blended vision. It is pressed by lasik plus a slight spherical aberration that is induced, which increases the depth of focus for the patient. Next, coming on to RELEX, which is refractive lenticule extraction. This is an all femtosecond laser based procedure in which the lenticule is cut within the cornea and the lenticule is extracted. Depending upon how the lenticule is extracted, it is of two types. One is the femtosecond lenticule extraction or the FLEX, as you can see here. With the help of a femtosecond, a lenticule is created within the cornea. Then the flap is created. And in this case, the flap will be lifted and the lenticule will be extracted. And it is approved for myopia up to minus 10 spherical equivalent with or without astigmatism up to minus 5 diopter. Next comes the small incision lenticule extraction, which is also known as minimally invasive RELEX, as you can see, there are four types of cut in this. The first is the posterior cut, which is the refractive cut. Second is the vertical cut that extends from the posterior cut till the anterior cut. This one was the anterior cut. And now the side incision will be created. So the difference between FLEX and SMILE is that in SMILE, a very small incision is used to extract the lenticule, while in FLEX, entire flap is lifted to remove the lenticule. In 2018, the SMILE was approved by FDA for myopia up to minus 10 diopter with astigmatism of minus 0.75 to 3 diopters. And the spherical equivalent should not be more than minus 10 diopter with age of more than equal to 22 years. Next, the advantages of RELEX over femtolasic. First is that single laser is required. Then refractive predictability is very high because the lenticule is cut rather than ablated, because ablation can be irregular sometimes. And since the example laser ablation rate also depends on the corneal hydration status and environmental factors. Next, the amount of tissue required per diopter of treatment is smaller than ablation because there is no peripheral loss of energy which can be seen with the ablation. And the total energy used is lower than in the lasik because in ablation, the amount of ablation also depends upon the time for total energy used for ablation also depends on the amount of refractive error to be corrected. While in SMILE, the same amount of energy is used and it is independent of the refraction to be corrected. Furthermore, in SMILE, there are no flap related complications. There is faster healing, surgical time is very less, and less dry eye problem. As you can see here in LASIK, you can see there is a full almost 20 millimeter round incision made in the cornea to lift the flap, as compared to SMILE, in which only a 2 to 4 millimeter incision is created. So more number of corneal nerves are damaged in LASIK as compared to SMILE. Disadvantage with SMILE is that there is a very steep learning curve and complications are often very difficult to manage.
Yeah, one thing to add here, when you go for an all femto LASIK procedure compared to an ordinary femto with eczema combination, both the flap and the minuscule cut, the lenticule cut is all done in a closed corneal scenario. Whereas in femtolasic, the flap is raised and then the laser is delivered. So whatever calculations the ablation has been fed has been changed when we do a flap raise and then an eczema laser. So all of these lead to more of unpredictability, whereas in femto, the cut is also performed in an unopened flap. So that way the result is better. Go ahead.
Yes. Next, coming on to the surface ablation. First is photorefractive keratectomy. In surface ablation, the most important is that the epithelium is first debrided. The reason for epithelial debridement is that the epithelium, it ablates faster and at a very irregular rate than the corneal stroma. So the need for epithelial debridement. And first is photorefractive keratectomy. In this, the Bowman's layer is exposed for Excimer ablation by epithelial debridement. So epithelial debridement can be done with a sharp blade, as you can see here, with a blunt spatula, with a rotary corneal brush, or we can put 20% alcohol in optical zone marker for 10 to 45 seconds, or we can use absolute alcohol, isopropyl alcohol. And next, mechanical microkeratome can also be used with an epilasic blade. But in this case, this flap that is created, which is the epithelial flap, is discarded. This technique is known as epilasic F4 technique, which is epilasic flap off technique. And epithelial ablation can also be done with the Excimer laser. In this case, as you can see, there is a blue fluorescence which is seen, So with completion of the epithelial ablation, this blue fluorescence will disappear, and this will point to the end point of epithelial debridement.
One point I want to add, Aman. How the laser is being delivered is the depth of the laser to be given to a surface reference plane. So when the epithelium is on and that forms a reference plane, and if that is irregular, so the resultant ablation zone is going to sort of mirror the surface. So all irregularities of the surface is going to be mirrored onto the ablated base. So if you deprive the epithelium, you produce a regular surface of the Bowman's. So and then when you start, your predictability becomes.
Next, coming on to LASIK procedure, which is LASIK laser assisted subepithelial keratinolysis. These two procedures, LASIK as well as epiLASIK, are epithelial preservation techniques in which the epithelium is not discarded. So in LASIK, epithelium is loosened with 20% alcohol for 20 seconds, and then the sheet of epithelium is folded back. Whereas in epiLASIK, there is no use of any chemical, but epikeratome is used, which is made for lifting an epithelial flap. And the best advantage of this is that in case of any flap complication, the procedure can always be converted directly into a PRK. The ideal candidate for surface surgery is mild to moderate myopia up to -7 diopter or a hyperopia up to 4 diopter.
Okay, I have done both the procedures. Technically, LASIK is easier because you use an alcohol and then you peel it off easily. But the epiLASIK requires a docking and suction and blunt blade has to run through and all that. Technically, that is more challenging. The patient will feel a little pressure and be a little sensitive. An apprehensive patient, it becomes a little difficult. But electron microscopic results have shown that epiLASIK, the basement membrane is smoothly stripped and it is very even, whereas in alcohol use, there are remnants and irregular peeling. So technically speaking, epiLASIK should be better. Go ahead.
So the treatment is done in the same manner as it was done with the LASIK. And before treatment, in this case, we should also ensure that the stromal bed is free of any epithelium, which can result in irregular astigmatism later on. Then examined laser is applied, and immediately after the treatment, in case of a PRK, a pledget soaked in mitomycin C, which is 0.02% or 0.2 mg/mL, is kept for 1 minute, or roughly it can be kept for 10 seconds for every diopter of correction. And in case of LASIK and epiLASIK, the epithelial sheet is floated back into position using a balanced salt solution. Plus, topical antibiotics, NSAIDs and steroids are put at the conclusion of surgery, and patient is BCL is put, or in case if the patient is intolerant to BCL, a pressure patch can be done. This is done until re-epithelialization has occurred. Then there are various ablation profiles for examined laser. First is the non-customized or conventional ablation, which treats only the lower order aberrations such as myopia, hyperopia, and astigmatism. And it induces more higher order aberrations, for example, spherical and coma aberration, because of an effect which is known as the cosine effect. As you can see here, the laser is emanating from the center. So those rays that are reaching the periphery, they have oval shape. So the energy gets distributed over a larger area, which results in less of ablation in the periphery than in the center. So a very small blend zone is created. To overcome this, different optimized ablation is used, in which it increases the number of pulses that are delivered to the peripheral cornea, and so it does not induce any new higher order aberrations, but at the same time it is not addressing any pre-existing higher order aberrations that may be present in the patient. And it is also faster than the next wavefront guided ablation. Now the wavefront guided ablation, also known as the customized ablation, this is basically an aberrometry guided ablation. It addresses both the lower order aberration as well as pre-existing higher order aberrations by correcting the wavefront deviations by application of very complex ablation pattern, and it requires a very accurate iris registration and pupil tracking. And it has a benefit over wavefront optimized is that ablation only it is beneficial only in those patients who have pre-existing higher order aberrations, and it is not suitable for patients with who have multifocal IOL, who have a very small pupil or irregular corneas, because these conditions, they, for example, MFIOL, they present a problem with capturing of the wavefront data, and in small pupil, the wavefront data will be very limited. Then in highly irregular corneas, the wavefront data may not be obtainable. So you can see here, the original shape of the cornea is this. Without wavefront optimization, as you can see, there is a abrupt transition also. And since ablation results in a more oblate cornea, so in order to keep a more prolate shape even after the treatment, wavefront optimization can be used, which smoothens this transition here. Next is topographic guided ablation. So in this, the treatment is linked to the corneal topography rather than the total wavefront data, and it is used to treat the pre-existing corneal irregularities in case of smaller decentered optical zone and in LASIK flap complications.
Yeah, let us pause a little bit because these three are very important concepts to understand for everyone. So wavefront optimized, wavefront guided, and topo guided. So these are three different things. Wavefront optimized, as we had shown in the next slide, it changes. Can you go back, Shauna? Yeah, it changes the way in which the laser is being delivered, so that post LASIK, the curvature of the cornea is not just like a flat top table, or rather it maintains sort of the pre-LASIK curvature. So that way, the aberrations are not induced by the laser itself. Okay, so wavefront guided, that is wavefront optimized. So wavefront guided is indicated for patients who have significant optical aberrations pre-LASIK. So the scope of optical aberrations can be cornea, lens, or anything else inside the eye, vitreous or whatever, other aqueous media, all of these things can contribute. So the major contributor is either the cornea or the lens. So all of these are going to be corrected onto the cornea. So this is a very bold step done. So it has to be very specifically measured, and the measured aberration should be sort of a stable one, so that for a longer period of time, whatever has been done will give a stable result. The topo guided is only meant for corneal aberrations, while the lens aberrations are normal. So if the patient's visual problem, apart from the lower rod aberration, also has a significant irregular cornea, for example, post LASIK, say a wrinkled flap, first flap, you want to redo a residual, or post cataract surgery, post RK, post PK, all of these patients can have a very irregular cornea. So you want to regularize that specifically because you know that's not normal. In those scenarios, a topo guided ablation will be a good option. I think I've made it clear. Please go ahead. Yes.
Now coming on to the complications in LVC. So first, the complications which are related to laser ablation. So there can be instances when there is overcorrection as well as undercorrection. First, coming on to the overcorrection. So the common causes for both is incorrect pre-op refraction or incorrect treatment application, or there is a faulty laser calibration. Poor humidity control, for example, if there is a very high humidity, it will result in corneal hydration, and which decreases the ablation that is done, because the amount of ablation delivered per pulse will be low. In case of a poor humidity level in the operating room, the corneal dehydration occurs and there will be excessive excessive ablation. Next, in older patients, for unknown reasons, the ablation occurs very much amount of ablation occurs in older patients. Then in high emmetropic treatment also, there are chances of undercorrection. Then sometimes we tend for elective undercorrection also, especially in high myopes, because the residual stromal bed may not be forgiving for the complete correction. In elective overcorrection, we can do in surface ablation because of regression which occurs after the surface ablation. Then the treatment for over and under correction is that the retreatment should be done till the refractive stability has been reached. So in case of a myope, it is usually 2 to 6 months, and in case of hyperope, it is after 6 months, and it is usually aberrometry guided treatment. And one more thing, what we can do is that we can accelerate the steroids so that regression can be achieved. This is done usually in overcorrection, and aggressive use of steroids can be done to prevent this regression, which can be done if there is an undercorrection to prevent further regression.
Okay, so all these things are easily said than done. Retreatment, before going to retreatment, there are a lot of parameters you have said, a lot of reasons which can lead to overcorrection or undercorrection. Assuming that all of these are very strictly followed, there are still certain things which are out of the hands of the surgeon that can lead on to variation in the predicted outcome. Can somebody tell me what are all the possibilities? He has mentioned like humidity. Humidity can be controlled. Anything else? Conyo fellows, quickly. I will give you a clue. Temperature of the room. Next. Atmospheric pressure. The altitude at which, nobody knows, the altitude at which the machine is placed from the sea level. Each machine has got its own value of humidity. So the engineers are the right persons to tell you for a given machine what is the perfect humidity. Similarly, every machine installation, these things are noted into, taken into account. So these are the things which are some extent controllable, to some extent it is not. The way in which each cornea reacts to laser could be variable. So in spite of all these things, it is important to counsel the patient of a possible unpredictability. As long as the unpredictability is minimum and the patient is able to do the overall day-to-day activity without spectacle, he is going to be happy. So there is a little amount of residual correction possible in spite of the best efforts, and that will fall into a 90-95% range. It is very important to counsel the patient.
Next is the dry eye. Shall I go ahead, ma'am?
Yeah, go ahead.
So the causes for dry eye in case of a LASIK procedure can be, the first is that there is a damage to the corneal nerve plexus. So because of the cutting, there is a cutting of the nerve during the flap creation as well as during lifting the flap, as well as there is a direct damage to the corneal nerve plexus during ablation also. And with higher refractive correction and deeper ablation, there is more incidence of dry eye. Next is loss of conjunctival goblet cell, which occurs because of the application of the suction ring. So there is a decrease in production of mucin post-op. Next is a pre-existing dry eye problem. So the patient may come with certain symptoms that can point towards this, such as contact lens intolerance pre-op, or the patient may complain of fluctuating vision in between the blinks, or symptoms that are worsening towards the end of the day because of increasing dryness towards the end of the day. Next, there can be missed chronic blepharitis during examination. And furthermore, there is a LASIK-induced change in the corneal shape, so which changes the relationship between the ocular surface and the eyelid, and so there will be abnormal tear film distribution. So the preventive measure for these are that meticulous dry eye workup should be done, and a pre-existing dry eye treatment should be done. A meticulous dry eye workup will also ensure that the pre-op measurements are also accurate, as well as the post-op outcomes are also precise. Next, the management is as same as a simple dry eye. And these symptoms usually improve over a period of 6 to 12 months as the corneal re-innervation again occurs. Next, coming on to LASIK ectasia. So the risk factors are that the cut is made, in case of a LASIK, is made in the anterior third of the cornea. And as we know that the anterior third of the cornea has a greater tensile strength than the posterior two-third. So during flap creation, there is a certain weakening of the cornea. Second is if there are pre-existing risk factors on corneal topography or tomography, then in younger patients, thinner corneas, and in high myopic correction. So the management will be the same as a normal LASIK.
Here, the one second, just go back to the previous slide. So the flap creation weakens the cornea because it cuts through the anterior third of the cornea, which is the strongest biomechanically. Whereas in SMILE, that does not happen. You have only a small pocket incision, and rest of the anterior surface of the cornea is well maintained. This also leads to lesser cut on the corneal nerves. So in both ways, SMILE is biomechanically more stable and less dry eye. It is better than the conventional flap-based LASIK. Go ahead.
This is a corneal topography picture. As you can see, this part, which is shown in blue, is the flatter part as compared to the periphery. And this here denotes the visual axis. This means that in this case, the laser was not applied coinciding with the visual axis. Rather than it was applied most probably with the center of the cornea, which results in a decentered ablation. So the causes for decentered ablation are poor centration of the laser, and improper head positioning or head tilt, Then hyperopic ablation, high refractive correction in inexperienced surgeon, because it increases the treatment time. And so because of the increase in treatment time, there are more chances that the patient might move his head. Then the treatment for this is topography guided ablation. Next comes the corticosteroid induced complication. So in case of a steroid responders, the there is a risk of increase in IOP. And this risk is more in surface ablation due to the longer course of the steroids. Then cataract can form and there can be a reactivation of HSV keratitis also. So in the post laser vision correction, the Goldman inclination tonometry is very inaccurate. So more accurate will be a dynamic contour tonometry. Then due to the high IOP, there might be fluid in the flap interface, which can also mask dangerously high IOPs, especially in the steroid responders. Then coming on to infectious keratitis. So the risk is more in surface ablation, because in surface ablation, there are certain risk factors such as we are creating an iatrogenic epithelial defect, further we are using BCL after the procedure, and topical steroids are also used, which can exaggerate the fungal keratitis also. So the most common agent being the gram-positive organisms such as Staphylococcus aureus, the methicillin-resistant Staph aureus, the Streptococcus pneumoniae and Streptococcus viridans, atypical mycobacteria such as Mycobacteria chelonae, Nocardia asteroides, and fungi such as Candida and Fusarium. The risk in flap procedure could be because of sequestration of the lid and conjunctival flora in the flap interface. So the management will be the same as a normal infectious keratitis, and culture and sensitivity of the bandage contact lens as well as corneal scrapings can be done, which should also include the fungal assays. Then in case of a LASIK, we can also do a flap lift. We can scrape the stromal bed for culture and sensitivity and irrigate the stromal bed with antibiotics at the same time. And the differential diagnosis for infectious keratitis will be diffuse lamellar keratitis, sterile peripheral corneal infiltrate, epithelial ingrowth, and interface debris.
Okay, what are the dangers or what are the seriousness where post-LASIK infection happens compared to a normal ulcer? Quickly, can somebody tell
me? High chances of perforation because of thin flap.
Why?
Because the corneal thickness is already less.
Okay, and the eye is already inflamed. Infection has occurred in an already inflamed eye due to surgical intervention. Okay, good. Next.
It's difficult to take do scraping, and microbiological investigation is difficult if it's under the flap and LASIK.
Okay, when it is sequestered on the interface, it is difficult. Okay, then anything else? In case of surface ablation, is it the same as a large ulcer that you see? Surface ablation, you have, what is the area of epithelial defect?
The centralized area.
What is the area of epithelial defect in a post-LASIK, epi-LASIK, whatever? Quite a large zone, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
8.59 mm. So in that, if you have an ulcer or an infection, it is going to spread very fast. So you don't have time like in a normal ulcer where the breach of epithelium happens as the ulcer proceeds. Here you have the protection already knocked off and then you have an infection. So the spread of infection and melt is going to be very severe. And what other difference you have between the source of infection? Is there any difference between a post-LASIK infection and a normal routine corneal ulcers, whatever with whatever history?
Atypical organism, mycobacteria are common.
Mycobacteria.
And because the epithelial barrier is damaged in post-LASIK patients, so the organisms that were not able to penetrate with the barrier can be seen in the patient with post-LASIK.
And what is the source of those organisms? Air? Air, what is the source of those organisms? What do you call those organisms? Commensals.
Commensals.
Yeah. So here mostly it is usually commensals which happen in the early post-LASIK.
Yeah.
So these are the organisms. Whereas in an ulcer post-trauma, it will be the source. If it is a vegetative matter, it will be fungus. If it is a contact lens, it will be Pseudomonas. Okay. So the history will predict the organism. Here it is usually the commensal. Why fungal infection is also common here? These patients are all on local immunosuppression. So anytime you have an immunosuppression, you have the risk of fungal infection. Okay. So in all these cases, this infection is different from the routine keratitis, ulcers. So they require very close follow-up and aggressive treatment. Okay. Fine. Go ahead.
Next, coming on to the complications that are unique to LASIK. So the complications can occur during flap creation, during flap replacement, and some may occur in the interface also. So during flap creation, one of the complications is incomplete cut. So the causes for incomplete cut are there is a loss of suction, or if there is an electrical or mechanical block in the microkeratome itself, or in the cases of steep corneas. So as you can see here, the cut has been stopped till here. So the next incision should be deeper to the previous cut. So the management with the microkeratome can be that if the microkeratome stops unexpectedly, we should reverse the run direction and then remove the suction ring. Then we should see if sufficient room for ablation is available or not, which means that if the optical zone is of reasonable dimension or not. So if it is of reasonable dimension, we can proceed with the treatment. Otherwise, if the optical zone is inadequate, we should first of all not lift the flap, or if in case we have lifted the flap, we should replace it without any ablation. And the retreatment should be done after 3 to 6 months, but with a deeper cut, as you can see in the figure, or we can opt for a surface ablation also. With femtolasic, if there is a loss of suction which occurs outside the visual axis, we can replace the suction ring and then continue the cut at the same depth. But if it is close to the visual axis, we should suspend the procedure and follow the same as it has been described for microkeratome earlier.
So what is the cause for loss of suction? Could be the cause for loss of suction.
Ma'am, either eyelashes could come between the suction cup and the conjunctiva, or
okay,
a lot of
not properly fixed in the first place.
Yeah.
Okay, so the suction ring is not properly placed in the pseudo suction. You have held only the conjunctiva, not the sclera, right? Then anything else, the patient can move. So it's very important to arrest the patient's head and neck movement. Because of the pressure, the patient might tend to tilt his chin down. So that is a very common thing. So you'll have to consciously hold the patient's chin sometimes to untilt the head also slightly to avoid this complication. Go ahead.
So the next complication is a thin or perforated cut, which is also known as buttonholing of the flap. The causes for this are suction loss, excessive dry cornea, poor quality blade of the microkeratome, or in the case of a steeper corneas, it can also happen. The management consists of, if in case it is a very thin flap, but in this case we should abandon the treatment. But if in case it can be raised, it can be raised, but it should be treated very delicately. Then, in case of a buttonhole flap, it should be repositioned and it should be left for 3 months, and the interface should also be irrigated to remove any epithelial cells which might have entered into the interface during the buttonholing, and the B cell should also be placed until re-epithelialization occurs. And here you can see in a buttonhole flap also, the re-incision will be deeper to the previous depth.
In a buttonhole flap, my best opinion is not to do LASIK at all because of the unpredictable results and high risk of epithelial ingrowth and other complications. It is better not to do at the same setting. Wait for the things to be, and then later on can do a surface procedure if possible. Go ahead.
Next comes the free cap. So the free cap means that there is no hinge, and a part of the cornea has completely separated from the cornea. So the causes are corneal diameter more than 14.5 millimeter, or flat cornea less than 40 diopters, poor microkeratome assembly or maintenance, and inadequate suction and apprenation. And in case of corneal diameter and flatter corneas, such corneas, they protrude less inside the suction ring, so the less of the cornea will be presented to the blade. The management options are that if adequate ablation zone is available, the cap can be kept in a moist chamber, and we should always replace the cap with the epithelial side up, plus BCL should also be put to protect the cap. So here lies the importance of the corneal markings, and these more importantly is that these markings should be asymmetric, so that in the event of a free cap, they can be reposited properly. And the markings, as I mentioned earlier, should be made prior to microkeratome cutting. Yeah, and in case of a femtolasic, it should be made before lifting the flap, because if we make it before photo disruption, there will be interference with the photo disruption procedure itself. Next comes the corneal perforation. So it can be seen in very thin corneas or in older microkeratome models. Then epithelial sloughing and defect. So the risk factors are old age, epithelial basement membrane dystrophies, and if there was an epithelial defect in the first eye, then it also increases the chances in the second eye. Then prevention is very, very important, since it is epithelial defects are associated with diffuse lamellar keratitis, infectious keratitis, flap stries, and epithelial ingrowth. So prevention options can be to limit the medications pre-op, specifically the topical proparacaine, because excessive use can lead to more chances of epithelial defect. And moreover, we should use non-preserved medications. The management includes BCL until re-epithelialization plus intensive lubrications should also be done. Next are the complications that can occur after flap replacement. So first, it is flap stries, the risk factor.
I just want to make a stress on the judicious use of topical anesthetics during the procedure, because all the other factors will be meticulously checked and ruled out. But an extra usage of topical anesthetic, especially in a very young surgeon apprehensive about the procedure, will lead on to loosening of the epithelium, and that will lead on to a lot of complications. So very, very cautious about the use of topical anesthetic during the procedure, just before the procedure when everything else is ready, not much earlier.
So next comes flap stry. So the flap stry, the risk factors are, first is excessive irrigation under the flap, because excessive irrigation can cause edema of the flap, so there can be mismatch after replacing the flap. Extremely thin flaps are themselves very prone for stry formation. Then deeper ablation will also result in a mismatch of the flap to the new bed. Then flap displacement can occur if the patient rubs his eyes in the post-op period, or if there is any unintentional trauma while putting eye drops or squeezing, excessive squeezing of the eyes. Then intra-op also, if there is an incorrect repositioning of the flap itself, it can lead to stry. And treatment of a severe myopia, because more amount of ablation will be done in that. Next, the striae are of two types. First is micro striae, and the other is macro striae. It is very important to differentiate between them, because macro striae will result in a decrease in the vision. So micro striae are basically folds in the Bowman's membrane. They are usually asymptomatic, and they can be visualized with negative staining with a fluorescein, or they can also be viewed in retroillumination. Then macro striae, they are full thickness folds in the flap itself, and most commonly they occur because of the flap slippage, which can be due to the above mentioned reasons, and it usually results in a decrease in the BCVA. So the management option is that first we will determine the best corrected visual acuity of the patient. If the visual acuity is good, no treatment is generally required. But if in case the BCVA is affected, so prompt treatment is required, because the folds can become fixed, which could be due to epithelial hyperplasia in the valleys of the flap and hypoplasia of the epithelium over the elevations. So the management option in this case, first is that we can refloat the flap, we can irrigate the interface, and then reposit it again, and we should stroke the flap perpendicular to the striae so as to smoothen the folds. Next can be, if the folds have become fixed, we can do a de-epithelialization using distilled water, because distilled water will result in epithelial edema, and the de-epithelialization can be done very easily. Next, the interface should be irrigated with BSS and not with distilled water, because it will result in stromal edema also then, and then we should reposit the flap. If all these have failed and the folds are very intractable, we can do a continuous 10-0 nylon suturing, but the problem is it creates a lot of post-op astigmatism, or we can opt for a phototherapeutic keratectomy also. Next comes the flap dislocation. The flap dislocation causes will be excessive squeezing of the eye or rubbing of the eye, trauma to the eye, and dryness of the flap or the eye, because of the dryness, there will be adhesions between the flap and the upper tarsal conjunctiva, which can displace the flap. Then management will be immediate repositioning of the flap is very important. Next, coming on to the interface complications. So the interface complication, diffuse lamellar keratitis, which is also known as the shifting sands of Sahara. So this is a non-specific sterile inflammatory response to foreign substances under the flap. And foreign substances could be trapped meibomian secretions or povidone iodine or any marking aid, etc. Under the flap. And the symptoms range from asymptomatic interface haze near the edge of the flap to a very diffuse haze under the center of the flap. And there are four stages. The stage one is that peripherally we can see WBCs, which have a very granular appearance. Stage two is central scattered WBCs with a granular appearance. Stage three is central dense WBCs in the visual axis. And stage four will be prominent scarring or stromal melting. So early detection and management is very important. As you can see, it can progress from stage one to stage four. So in case of stage one and two, topical steroids can be used, while in case of stage three and four, the flap should be lifted and irrigation should be done. And moreover, because of lifting the flap, we can also remove the inflammatory mediators and we can directly put the topical steroid and NSAIDs to suppress the inflammation. And if in case there is no response to these treatment within 7 to 10 days, we should reconsider our diagnosis because it can be an infectious keratitis also, in which case we will be required to stop the steroid treatment. Next, it is very important to differentiate a DLK from an infectious keratitis. So in a DLK, it usually appears within 24 hours, whereas infectious keratitis will usually present after 24 hours, and pain and redness will be more in case of infectious keratitis. Diffuse lamellar keratitis, as you can see, it begins at the periphery, and there is a gradient of inflammation, which is intense. Inflammation is present at the periphery, which decreases towards the center in the early stages. Then, as you can see in the diagram, the inflammation is confined to the interface only. It is neither going out of the interface nor going up and down. Whereas in case of an infectious keratitis, the inflammation is going above and below and even beyond the incision of the flap.
Yeah. One second, is there an infection which behaves like the diagram that you have shown for a DLK, which goes along the interface and does not penetrate above and below, at least in the early stages? Can you think of any cornea fellow? I can't remember, no? It grows along the surface. Which infection?
Slow growing mycobacteria, atypical mycobacteria.
Exactly. So whenever you see a lamellar spread and patient also reasonably asymptomatic, atypical mycobacteria should also be in the back of your mind. Is it, are you dealing with ELK or is it an infection of that sort type? Okay. Right.
And in diffuse lamellar keratitis, as the name suggests, there will be a diffuse inflammation, as you can see here. Whereas in case of infectious, there will be focal inflammation, which is usually present above the location of the infection. And in case of DLK, there will be minimal or no AC reaction. Whereas in infectious, there can be mild to moderate AC reaction as well. Next comes the pressure-induced stromal keratopathy, or PISK. So in this case, the pathophysiology is that because of the use of topical steroid, and in case the steroid response also occurs, there will be a high IOP, which leads to a diffuse stromal and interface opacity, as you can see here shown by the arrows here. And sometimes a fluid cleft can also be seen in the interface sometimes, as you can see this translucent area here. So the differential diagnosis for PISK will be DLK. But how can we differentiate is that DLK occurs very early and the IOP is usually not raised. So the management for PISK will be accelerated taper of the steroid plus anti-glaucoma medications can also be used. And we should also have a caution by IOP monitoring because of the presence of the fluid cleft. The Goldman Ethmation tonometry might measure the pressure of this fluid compartment rather than the true intraocular pressure. So more reliable will be a dynamic contour tonometry.
Now you yourself said, just go back to that slide, you yourself said that IOP is not raised in DELK.
Yes.
So in case of PISK, the IOP will be pseudo normal or pseudo low. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So whenever you see some inflammation, some haziness in the surface, in the interface, and you have an abnormally low IOP. Okay. So you can compare it with the other eye. So abnormally low IOP, then it should go in favor of PISK. Is there any other place where you can measure the IOP and get an idea? Where the pressure will be low? Where when you check the pressure, it will be low? If you check over the flap, it will be low. Is there an area where you can check beyond the flap?
In peripheral cornea.
Okay, what tonometer will you use to do that?
You can use tonopen.
Tonopen comes in handy here. Whenever you are suspicious of a PISK, use a tonopen, check in two different areas. If there is a vast change or difference between the IOP values, then it goes in favor of PISK. Go ahead.
Okay.
I think I have answered.
Next
question. We had sent a message. I hope I have answered that question, doctor.
Thank you.
Yeah, go ahead.
Next comes the epithelial ingrowth. So the risk factors for epithelial ingrowth are epithelial defect at the time of procedure, lifting the flap for retreatment, and a traumatic flap dislocation. So the management for epithelial ingrowth includes if the epithelial ingrowth is present only peripherally and is not advancing, so usually no treatment is done. But if it is advancing towards the visual axis, as you can see the tract which has been formed by the epithelial ingrowth from the periphery towards the center, in this case it can result in an irregular astigmatism or a flap melting. So in that case we should lift the flap, we should scrape both the under surface of the flap as well as the stromal bed and ensure that complete epithelium has been removed from both the places.
Then so there it is because, one second, Aman, it is because of this reason, it is very, very important to do LASIK as if you are going to do it for the first time. All the pre-op values, indications should not be overlooked. Stability of refraction, disuse of contact lens, adequate time, age factor, and all those parameters are very important to consider. Because if the result is not up to predictable value and there is a need for retreatment, we are in for a big soup. See, the main problem with an epithelial ingrowth will be a re-LASIK. Okay, so that becomes very difficult to handle. Epithelial ingrowth in the periphery can be a treatment of just observation, whereas when an aggressively growing form, it can lead to graft melt also. So imagine a patient who wants supervision and ends back in a very poor vision needing keratoplasty. That is going to be a very traumatic event. So it is important to follow all the protocol when we do the procedure. Go ahead.
So there are certain complications that are seen with femto LASIK. The intraoperative complication first is vertical gas breakthrough. So in vertical gas breakthrough, there will be appearance of air bubble between the epithelium and the elimination cone. And it is because of passage of the air bubble through the stroma and epithelium which get ruptured. So in a way, it is a button holing that is happening similar to a micro, similar to that is seen with a microkeratome. So it is usually seen in a sub-Bowman's keratomyliosis because the flap thickness is very less. And in case there are previous wounds or scars on the cornea. Then anterior chain, in this case, in vertical gas breakthrough, the management will be the same as done for the button holding. Anterior chamber bubble appears because air passes through the Schlemm's canal. In this case, there will be problem with the iris, pupil tracking. So in this case, we can put a little amount of phenylephrine to dilate the pupil, like it will come beyond the air bubble and again the pupil tracking can be done. Then opaque bubble layer, it is appearance of air bubble in the interface during the creation of the flap using the femto LASIK. So early opaque bubble layer, it reduces the quality of the cut, which is known as masking effect. As you can see here, the early opaque bubble layer, it is going ahead of the raster pattern. So the cut here will not be very regular. The late opaque bubble layer, as you can see here, it is coming after the raster has passed. So it indicates that there are still adhesions that are remaining and will pose problem with the separation of the flap. Post-operatively, two complications are seen. One is transient light sensitivity syndrome and another is rainbow glare.
Yeah, in this first picture, what you have shown, the opaque bubble which is going before the femto laser, what should be done? Is there a difference between the two in the management? Anybody can tell me? Second picture, it happens after the laser has been delivered. So there will be no problem in lifting the flap. Okay, whereas in the first picture, it happens before. So most likely those areas are uncut. That's what Aman has nicely said. So what happens when the thing is uncut at this stage? This is close to the hinge. If the laser...
DM detached.
Pardon?
It can spread. It can spread to the lower area, like detachment.
Not necessarily. The question here is only about raising the flap. Okay. So when the opaque bubble is not escaping deeper, it's escaping more superficially. Okay. That's why it is seen above your laser area. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So it is not going deeper. If it goes deeper, you will clearly see your area of laser zone. Okay. So this is happening superficially. So if the opaque bubble happens above and before the laser, And if it is confined to the periphery and we are able to expose the area of ablation, we can still go ahead with the treatment. If it is obscuring your pupillary area and you're not able to lift the flap adequately for ablation, then it should be avoided. Go ahead.
Yes. Then coming to the complications which are unique, this complication is not unique. Seen in surface ablation, persistent epithelial defect, the causes can be keratoconjunctivitis thicca, then diabetes mellitus, connective tissue disorders and smokers, because in these three, they have a very poor epithelial healing. The management will be dry eye treatment and topical NSAIDs should be discontinued and oral tetracyclines can be given because they have anticholagenase effect. Next is corneal haze, which corneal haze can also be seen after LASIK, but it is more seen after PRK. So it appears several weeks after the laser vision correction and it peaks at 1 to 2 months and then it diminishes over 6 to 12 months. The cause for this is that there is an increased activity of the stromal keratocytes after ablation, which leads to abnormal glycosaminoglycans and non-lamellar collagen deposition, which leads to the haze. So severe haze is associated with greater correction or a smaller ablation zone. Then management is, if there is a clinically unacceptable haze, then we can do a superficial keratectomy or a phototherapeutic keratectomy. And as you can see, there is a reticular pattern that is seen in the haze, which is characteristic of post-LVC corneal haze. Another entity is late onset haze, which is usually seen between 4 to 14 months post-op, and it is due to the UV exposure. So the patient is asked to wear sunglasses when going out after the laser vision correction.
Yeah, very often the visible haze need not always be symptomatic. So all the interventions are done only when it is symptomatic, when there is a visual depreciation. Otherwise, you don't have to intervene at all. Yes, longer duration of lubricants, slow tapering of steroids, exposure to sunlight, these are all the modality. But when you want to do a PTK or something like that, it is only indicated when there is a severe depression of vision, symptomatic. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So the further discussion will be done by the cornea fellows, starting with Dr. Pranesh, who will be speaking on general keratoconus screening. Over to you, Dr. Pranesh.
It's already going to be 7 in 10 minutes. Shall we go ahead with these quick presentations or do you want to call it stop? Shall we go ahead?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, first. Okay, quickly.
Okay. Hi everyone. So I'll just be talking about the general screening for keratoconus in just one slide. So starting with the screening for keratoconus, our primary goal primarily comes across like to differentiate between if the patient is having a keratoconus or not having keratoconus. So with regards to this, it is very easy to find if a patient is having a significant clinical keratoconus because all the signs and the slit lamp findings which you see are from patients who have clinical keratoconus. So our screening as far as refractive surgery or in that perspective is to find patients who are having subclinical or formiferous keratoconus. So that differentiation should be brought about, which is very of great importance. Starting with history, you ask the patient if the patient is having any history of eye rubbing, which is due to allergy, because this can mold the cornea and cause a keratoconus. So we all know the prominent external signs like Oak's tray and Rizzuti's sign, which can be seen in almost all cases of frank keratoconus. History-wise, these patients will usually have a frequent change in glasses if the keratoconus is progressive. And as far as refraction is concerned, you might have an irregular or a mixed astigmatism as a due to keratoconus. And normally when you see a patient, for any patient who's having a gross refractive error, they usually do a manual keratometry. And if you find a manual K more than 47.2 diopters in either of the axes, then it should suspect you towards the patient having keratoconus. And always, if the patient is having a bilateral keratoconus, it may not that both keratoconus progress at the same lineage. One eye can progress in faster and other eye can be static. So now talking about what the screening test is going to do is, now we will differentiate between a patient who is having a subclinical and clinical keratoconus from a normal patient. So the primary investigation I want to talk about first is the most sensitive one. So starting from anterior to posterior, anteriorly we have something called as OCT based epithelial thickness profile, So it was found, and this is a very sensitive indicator to find early keratoconus. In OCT-based epithelial thickness profile using OptoView OCT, you can find a donut pattern, as you can see in this picture. So the central blue area, which is flatter, you'll find a donut pattern. What happens is, the steeper part of the anterior surface, the epithelium kind of tends to move away and it tends to be thinner. And as you move towards the base of the bone, the epithelium tends to be thicker. So you find a donut pattern, which is very sensitive indicator for early keratoconus. Next slide, Aman, next slide.
Yeah.
So, and when you come to pentacam, the most sensitive part is the posterior float. Posterior float, if the patient has, usually we see best fit sphere here. If a patient has more than 18 diopters of in myopia and 28 diopters of hypermetropia are mixed in the central 5 millimeter, then that means that the patient has got keratoconus or early keratoconus, because the posterior surface is more sensitive for a patient who is having keratoconus. And then next slide. Come on, next slide. Okay. And then next, we have something which is called as an ocular response analyzer, which measures the corneal hysteresis and the corneal resistance factor. So basic funda with the ocular response analyzer is one air pulse will be given. So it will just see how elastic the cornea is. As we know, keratoconic corneas are more weaker and they'll be more elastic. So what you'll see in the subclinical keratoconus picture, you can see this few reverberations after the second peak. So this usually happens because they kind of tend to flutter after the air pulse has been given. But nowadays, ORA is not being done because the repeatability of the air pulse is very poor. So that's why we have shifted to Corvus. So as far as Corvus, we have something called as Vinciguerra. Come on, next slide. Vinciguerra screening report. So this is what Corvus does. So Corvus, it takes the same concept of ORA and it also takes the pentacam data, and it will give you two values. It is called as CBI, or the corneal biomechanic index, and TBI, which is called as a tomographic biomechanical index. CBA more than 0.50 and a TBA more than 0.79. So this should be suggestive of, if it crosses beyond this, then this should be suggestive of a keratoconic eye. So that's what this graph, the red and green will show the red pointing towards abnormality, green point towards a normality, and the in-between graph between these two will tell you that overlapping area. So the black line denotes where the patient's biomechanical index lies. So these are the common tests which will be able to help you in screening out a patient who's having a subclinical or a clinical keratoconus from a normal eye. Thank you.
Yeah, the next one.
Hello everyone. I am going to explain about the bad display, which is the Bellin Ambrosio Enhanced Ectasia display. The basic concept of this display was, it was created with the combination of elevation maps and pachymetric indices to give a comprehensive overview of the cornea to rule out any preclinical keratoconus cases if there is any. So the bad display gives the elevation value front and back, which is the top two. You can see the top two are the front elevation value taken out with the reference, standard reference sphere, as you can see in the left. Then there is something called enhanced reference sphere, in which which utilizes the standard best fit sphere and modifies it by eliminating a central 4 millimeter zone, which surrounds the thinnest location of the cornea or apex of the cornea. So finally, the reference sphere which has been created, it is created by the average value of the surrounding values away from the cone. So naturally, it will be flatter from the standard best fit sphere, and hence the values which are shown in the elevation maps in the middle, they are higher than the one which are shown in the top figures. So because the second figure shows the values of enhanced elevation values with reference to the NN sphere. And the final, the last two diagram shows the difference between the numerical values of elevation between the two maps. So in this way, we can see if there are any subclinical cases. So red values will denote that there is a significant difference between the two values. Also in bed display, towards the right in red box, you can see there is something called as progression index, which is the pachymetric progression index. This denotes the change of corneal thickness from the thinnest point and towards the periphery. So the average value, which is the second number in the box, the average value, if it is more than 1.1, it is suggestive of keratoconus. And if the difference between the thinnest point and the peripheral thickness of the cornea is more, the average value will be more. However, this progression index, pachymetric progression index, was not found to be completely reliable to differentiate between subclinical and keratoconic corneas. So later on in 2012, they introduced another pachymetric index, which is called ART, and which is actually the ratio between the thinnest point and the progressive pachymetric index. So in their study, they found out that the cutoff value of ART max was 339. And if they have given ART average, then it will be 424 micron cutoff should be considered for any keratoconic cases. Basically, they will differentiate between keratoconic corneas having relatively normal central corneal thickness. Finally, the most important parameter which should be looked upon in a bad display is the D value, which is given in the lower right corner. The D value, which is shown in the yellow. So this value actually is derived from a regression analysis of nine parameters, which are keratometry max and front and back elevation is the thinnest point, ART max, and five parameters at the which are given at the bottom, marked with a black circle, DT, DB, DP, DP, DT, and DA, which are basically standard deviation from normality of DF is front surface elevation deviation. Then DB is a back surface elevation deviation from the standard normal. And DP is a pachymetric progression standard deviation from the normal. And then thinnest point. And then there is something also called as DY, which is a deviation of y-axis of thinnest point from the corneal apex. So all these nine parameters, they have included in the regression multivariate analysis to find out the D value. And thus D value gives a global comprehensive overview of the cornea. And in a study, they have found that it is the most important factor to look upon for diagnosing any preclinical or keratoconic corneas. And they have found out that the cutoff value of 2.69, if it is taken, then it results in a 0% false positive rates. So these are the basic things which you should look into a bad display.
Yeah, so thanks, Ankit. So when you go for a screening for a refractive procedure, the important thing that you want to rule out is keratoconus. Preclinical keratoconus can be reliably diagnosed using the bad D parameters, as he has explained in the pentagram. Okay, so that is the important echo message for PGs. Next, who is going to present? Yeah,
I'm in the previous slide. Good evening, everyone. In the same map, we can assess the thickness profile of the patient, and it is a quick tool to differentiate between the abnormal cornea and the normal cornea. So here we have two parameters in the right bottom corner, which is the corneal thickness facial profile and the percentage thickness increase. So here what we do is, from the thinnest point in the cornea, the thickness is measured from the thinnest point going towards the periphery. And here the machine takes the thickness at the thinnest location, that is at zero, then at 2 millimeters, 4 millimeters, 6 millimeters, 8 millimeters, and 10 millimeters. So the horizontal axis is indicating this, while the vertical is indicating the thickness values. While the percentage thickness increases, the percentage increase in the thickness from the thinnest location towards the periphery. Now here you can see the red line, which indicates the line of the examined cornea, while the dotted line represents the average thickness of the normal cornea, and the upper and lower line represents the 95% confidence intervals. Now we can have different slopes in this. Now if this, you can see the slope, this is the normal. If the deviation of this red line occurs at or after 6 millimeters, it is considered to be normal. Now we can have certain abnormal parameters. Aman, next slide. So this is a patient of keratoconus, in which you can see before 6 mm, the graft deviated from its original path. And you can quickly assess that this is something which is not normal. Next slide.
This is the next slide, I think.
Aman, next. Click. So this can be the first pattern, which can be a quick slow, which you can get if the curve deviates before 6 mm, which can be seen in ectatic disorder. This is a S-shaped curve, which you can see when the curve deviates before 6 mm. Now here it is important that you should rule out the family history of keratoconus, and it can be an abortive form of keratoconus, formifrustrate keratoconus. There can be a flat shape. That means the cornea is edematous. That means from the thinnest point towards the periphery, the thickness is almost remaining the same. And it can be inverted shape. That means the periphery of the cornea is thin in comparison to the central point or the thinnest point which we took. So it is indicative of pellucid marginal degeneration. So now all these profiles indicate abnormal corneal thickness profiles. In the normal cornea, the progression index, as in Ankit discussed, it is 0.8 to 1.1. If it is more than 1.1, it is in the ectatic corneas or the thinner corneas. And if it is more than 1.1, it indicates the thicker corneas like the edematous, Fuchs dystrophy, or the pellucid. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Next, the last one.
No, ma'am.
Good evening, everyone.
Two more. Okay, fine.
So I'm going to talk about Holliday's equivalent keratometry reading, which is primarily used for IOL power calculations in post-refractive surgery eyes. So as you can see, upper middle panel, the Holliday report, that displays the equivalent K reading. The next slide, please. Yeah, so basically, as we all know, the refractive, any corneal refractive surgery alters the anterior shape of the cornea without affecting the posterior surface. So, and the Holliday's EKR, it does not require the preoperative patient data for calculation of IOL power. So, if we are using a standard keratometer and not the pentacam for measuring the keratometry values, it is not going to account for the power of the posterior surface of the cornea, which is measured by the pentacam. So the EKR takes into account the K value, adjusting it by subtracting the power of the back surface of the cornea from the normal. Now it was found by Dr. Holliday that the mean difference of EKR in the central 4.5 millimeter with the standard keratometry is just minus 0.06 diopter. So it is almost as accurate as the standard keratometers in untreated eyes. So now, in one of his articles, the accuracy of EKR. So I mentioned the standard deviation. For post-LASIK eyes, the keratometry values are, it can be plus or minus 0.56 diopters for one standard deviation. That is, for approximately 68% of the patients, the K values would lie anywhere between plus or minus 0.5 diopters. And similarly, for post RK eyes, it would be plus or minus 1 diopter. So this assumes its importance in patient counseling, that for cataract surgery and post corneal refractive surgery eyes, the patient has to be counseled that there can still be a possibility of a residual power, which can be fine-tuned with the techniques as described by Dr. Aman in his presentation. And mild myopia up to minus 0.5 or up to minus 1 diopters can be targeted for the target IOL power. That's it from my side. Thank you.
Yeah, so the idea of presenting this is to know that posterior corneal and anterior corneal curvatures when changed post-LASIK is important to look into it in case of IOL calculation later on. The next presenter, please. The last.
Yeah, so this is basically the holiday report. This is screen one of the holiday report, and this is the only screen which is relevant for LASIK screening. So there are six different maps on the screen right now. So the first map is the anterior or the axial sagittal curvature map. As you can see, there is inferior superior asymmetry, skewing of the axis, and there is a hotspot. That is an area of abnormal steepening at the 7 to 8 mm zone. Next, please. On the tangential map, which is more accurate, the peak is at 6 mm. So here when we, so the important part here is that when you are looking at the two maps, the axial map and the tangential map, the area of the hotspot is more reliably noted on the tangential map. And also note that the steps in the keratometry values are 0.5 in the axial map, whereas they're in 1 diopters in the tangential map. Then you look at the corneal thickness. The thinnest pecky is 1.07 mm inferior to the apex. If the thinnest pecky is greater than 0.6 mm inferior to the corneal apex, it is suspicious or a red flag sign. Now, the concept of relative pachymetry comes from the fact that because a negative meniscus lens has a predictable thickness from its center to periphery, the percentage thicker or thinner than normal at each point can be calculated. The value of minus 4.6% is the highest in this particular cornea, and it is borderline suspicious. Looking at the anterior float, that is an anterior elevation map and the posterior elevation map, the highest elevation in the anterior elevation map is plus 9 microns and the posterior elevation is plus 25 microns. The difference between the two is 16 microns and all three are abnormal. So the three important points here are: there is no one parameter that proves or disproves that ectasia exists. Cutoff values have been determined from a normative database. Values out of 2 standard deviation is considered normal. The clinching point here that the ectasia exists is that hotspot on a tangential map, thinnest pecky, maximum pecky difference, maximum anterior and posterior elevation, all these points coincide. And this shows that there is ectasia in this particular cornea. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, I think due to running out of time, I want to thank everybody who have prepared for the class nicely. Our fellows and Aman, and if anybody wants to add on anything, Meena, Dr. Meena, you want to add on something? Dr. Srivalli, what do you want to say?
I just want to add one point that in pediatric ophthalmology, there is a growing interest, or there is a group which now does LASIK for children as young as 10 years. For those children who are uncooperative to glasses, contact lenses, who have some kind of subnormal mentation, who do not cooperate. So they don't get full vision, but where patching and the treatment for amblyopia is totally not possible, there is an interest in this group to do LASIK actually. So in children, there's a small group of this kind which exists. Yeah, just wanted to add that.
Yeah. Agree with you, Meena. That is a very important aspect of LASIK. It is also equally challenging, and everything gets more complicated when it's a growing eye, you're going and doing an intervention. But the whole thing boils down to the fact that without correction, the child is going to go into amblyopia. In those scenarios, LASIK does have a role to play. Thank you, Meena. Dr. Sudhir is there, he wants to add on something?
I think he has left maybe.
Okay, so in that case, I thank everyone. It was a nice class.
Thanks, Dr. Nivedita. Can I just add a point?
Yes, please.
Thanks for a very detailed class. Just wanted to add that about pregnancy and breastfeeding, what was told, that better to wait 3 to 6 months after the breastfeeding has been stopped. And same situation like younger patients, it's important to ask in history about PCOD and hormone replacement treatment. Quite some people are on hormone replacements and in medications for vitamin A when the list of medications was coming, isotretinoin is important. Because quite some people are on treatment for acne, younger yes. people, cosmetic.
Agreed. Valid points taken, Srivali. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
So thanks, everyone. I call it a day.